I've been promoting system-wide VPNs on this channel for years, but I recently made a change that is a little bit controversial. I am not using a system-wide VPN anymore. Now, before you panic, I'm not going fully unprotected, but let me explain why I'm doing what I'm doing, and I think it'll make sense and get your gears turning, and it might actually work for some of you. And if it doesn't, system-wide VPNs are still awesome. So here's the thing. We've been conditioned that you either use a VPN or you don't. There are so many blogs that take these opposing sides. I get the anti-VPN sentiment because VPNs are really over-promoted, but I think some of those go a little too far on both ends of the spectrum. This is my breaking point story right here. I had to check in for a flight and I was scrambling around and I literally couldn't check in for my flight. So I do what I normally do, which is go to my system-wide VPN and I click disconnect. And this is something that happens on a daily basis. A banking app on my phone doesn't work. So I have to go into the system-wide VPN, turn it off, and then go back into the app, and then it lets me log in. I get captured every frickin' where I go. At a certain point, I just had to admit that using a system-wide VPN, even though it has legitimate privacy benefits, which I talk about in other content, was making my life pretty miserable. And part of my job back here is to tell you best case, but also give you my real life perspective on these things and what I'm doing in my personal life. So I came to the conclusion something needed to change. Now, I was thinking, who seems to have the least amount of issues with VPNs out there? And it's, ironically, the Apple people. Apple's private relay only runs in the browser, so it's not system-wide. But when you use Apple's private relay, you can only do it in Safari, which isn't my ideal browser. So why don't I just recreate what private relay does in any other browser? So I'd like to introduce to you the Proton VPN extension. Now, no, this is not sponsored by Proton. In fact, Windscribe has their own extension as well that should do the exact same thing I'm about to show you. I chose Proton because I already pay for a Proton subscription and it comes with Proton VPN for free. So what I've learned doing this job is that if you actually try to get something in a real life demo to block you when you're using Tor or VPN, it never does. It's always when things work. You can never catch it live. So we're going to pretend that I just accessed this website and Bank of America either captured me or it's like, hey, you literally can't log in. Normally with a system-wide VPN, you go up and then you click disconnect and now all your traffic is leaking anyway. So great. But here, let me show you this. So Proton VPN is currently connected and it's showing as protected. I go here, I go to split tunneling, add website, add Bank of America, boom. I'm still protected. All of my other tabs are still going through the VPN. And now if I refresh, it would theoretically let me in. Sadly, I couldn't get a frickin' website to actually block me for the live demo, but this is how it works. And it's fantastic and super convenient and makes it so you don't have to constantly turn your system-wide VPN on and off, which breaks the whole point of a system-wide VPN. Anyway, besides convenience for myself, and I would argue for a lot of other people, the main area where you actually want privacy is going to be from third parties. You want to hide your IP address when you're accessing 10 different websites. But if you install something on your system, like a banking app, a streaming app, etc., it's probably tied to you. You gave it your payment information, you gave it your social security number, etc. And so using your VPN and hiding your IP address isn't really giving you that much privacy. The main area where you're going to get a lot of privacy benefit is in the browser. This is where you're accessing hundreds of websites. Something else, upload speeds for me in the browser extension were twice as fast than when I was using a system-wide VPN. So again, let's go through the pros. Faster, more convenient, and also everything on your system will work. And you still get protection in the place where you need the most of it. And you gain access to your per site controls. The cons to this. Number one, this is actually not a full VPN. What this is it's a proxy extension that is essentially behind the word VPN. Now, you're still getting the number one benefit from a VPN, which is it's hiding your IP address. And that's how this is actually a little bit faster, is because it's running on a much lighter protocol than what you find with a VPN. A lot of you might be asking about WebRTC, which in your browser can leak your real IP address. That is something that you need to enable, but you still get access to secure core. You still can go in and disconnect. You can set different countries, different servers. And I find this to be very powerful. More cons. Of course, this is only going to be inside of your browser. So the main example of where you're not going to get protection is in something like an RSS feed. If you're using an RSS reader and you want all of those different things you follow to actually be hiding your IP address, you're not going to get as far with this. I still would argue that your browser is more important than your RSS reader, but still, that is a place you're not going to be getting as much protection. There's also mobile limitations. On iOS, most browsers are going to use a system-wide VPN for their VPN implementation, with the exception of Apple's private relay. So if you're on iOS, you can just go ahead and use Apple's private relay, and that is replicating this on mobile. But luckily on Android, split tunneling is pretty much built into every VPN client out there, and so the way to match this on Android is go ahead and install a system-wide VPN and just be a little bit more generous with what you disable with your VPN. I would argue most people don't need to use a VPN with their banking app. I would ask them what the real benefit to that is, and I think the arguments would fall apart pretty quickly. Another very niche con that I do want to introduce is that if you use the Mulvad browser, you will lose the whole like using the Mulvad VPN with the Mulvad browser. And it means you can't use the Mulvad extension, because the Mulvad extension, which is a proxy on top of their VPN, requires you to be connected to their VPN first, which is not how the VPNs I'm showing you, like ProtonVPN, they don't have that requirement. I will show you a hypothetical workflow where you can still use my VPN workflow and get access to Mulvad VPN in the Mulvad browser. So stick around for that. The second to last con is that this is just not a perfect solution. This is supposed to be a middle ground option for somebody who is really struggling to actually handle a 24/7 system-wide VPN workflow, and they are between that and getting rid of their VPN altogether because it's so frustrating. This is that middle ground where you're going to get very easy but still a lot of protection in the place that matters most. The last con, it's more of a neutral effect of this workflow. You will be pushing yourself to more web-based applications. A good example of this is your email client. If you're using a desktop email client, you're not going to get any more IP-based protection. But now, if you use Proton Mail in the web, you're going to get that IP-based protection. Of course, that's a pro and a con depending on who you are. So if you're looking at these cons and you're going, oh, that kind of sucks, let me actually help you out and help you fill in some of those gaps, because these are the worst case scenarios. First, many programs that are on your computer do have some layer of IP protection built in. For example, Signal has something called always relay calls, so that all of your calls get relayed through a Signal server so that your IP address doesn't get exposed to somebody else. Telegram has something similar, and you're going to find settings like this across different programs. Another place where you can fill in some gaps is a lot of programs let you customize a proxy address, so you can set up a proxy to still relay your IP address through some programs. Another thing you can do is using NextDNS, which is something I'm still running on my computers. This is system-wide, and it changes the DNS on your devices so that you can essentially do filtering, and it'll block things like malicious links, and it'll block ads, it'll block trackers, and it blocks a ton of stuff. I've done a lot of coverage on NextDNS. Another alternative is also from the Windscribe team called Control-D, and these are, in my opinion, a lot more important for the local apps you're installing than a VPN are. So if we're trying to essentially optimize for the most important for most people, I would personally say get a VPN in your browser, get a custom DNS that actually has really good filtering system-wide, and that would actually block a lot of important things for people. And of course, the other workaround is what is currently connecting, which is the Tor browser. I want you to know that if you're not using a system-wide VPN, there still are tools accessible to you that still give you the best protection. Tor will always be a very dedicated, safe space where you can still access things with the highest degrees of protection. So let's recap where I'm at so far. I've given you this middle ground solution that is between not having and having a VPN, and is something that will actually deal with 80% of most privacy concerns for the majority of people, but it doesn't give the same layer of perfect privacy as something like a system-wide VPN would, but we've given a few little patch jobs to make it a bit better. What now? Let's say this doesn't really resonate with you. First, traditional system VPNs are still perfectly valid and wonderful tools. They are an easy set-it-and-forget-it solution. If you don't want to deal with VPNs, but you don't want to do anything else, the second option is to just have Tor browser installed and use it when you're doing anything that needs a bit more privacy. It is going to give you a lot of protection. The third option is what I've given you guys today, which is essentially pretty much using a VPN only inside your browsers, and then maybe using something like a custom DNS provider in all other contexts to still kind of try to give yourself a bit more protection across the board, but really targeting the place that matters most. Again, this kind of depends on who you are. If you're installing a crap ton of stupid apps on your phone that are doing a lot of crazy stuff, then you might actually be sacrificing more of your privacy than somebody who's just doing most of their stuff in their browser. The fourth and very experimental approach is you can still set up what I did, and then you can install something like Mulvad VPN on your system, which has split tunneling. So what this would look like is go ahead and get like the Proton VPN extension or the Windscribe extension in something like Brave Browser or Firefox. Then install the Mulvad VPN system-wide, but then configure the split tunneling and pretty much disable everything by default and just enable the things where you want extra VPN protection, including the Mulvad browser. If you do this, then you can selectively choose something like your RSS reader to have a VPN, as well as Mulvad browser to have a VPN, and then you still have that nice proxy, speedy, convenient way of quickly excluding websites and getting fast speeds with fewer captchas in your regular browser, like something like Brave or Firefox. This is hypothetical because I haven't actually tested it yet, but I have no reason to think that it wouldn't work. So what should you do? I hope I didn't confuse you all and make you all just more hesitant to touch VPN. So let me break this down. Step one, audit your actual VPN usage. Where do you spend most of your internet time? Which apps are consistently breaking when you use a VPN? Are these apps you can't live without? Are they apps that even benefit from having a VPN? How often do you have to switch networks to avoid issues? Just ask yourself some of these questions, and if you don't know, just start keeping it in the back of your mind and using your devices like normal the next few days and seeing what comes up. Step two, define your threat model a little bit. You don't need to know exactly everything, but at least try to say, okay, what am I gaining from my VPN? What's the purpose of my VPN? Is there anything I really need to protect myself from? Do I need protection from torrenting, P2P activities? Step three, if you're unsure, test things out. I am constantly testing things out back here. I dove in and went ahead and uninstalled my system-wide VPN and just started doing this to see if I'd like it. And I fell in love with this. And this is what I'm going to keep doing for the indefinite future until I inevitably switch something again. It's really important to ask, especially with this whole system-wide VPN thing. Is your privacy tool actually helping your privacy if you have to keep disabling it? So as with most things, the reality is the best setup is the one that you'll actually stick to and consistently use. If a system-wide VPN makes you so frustrated that you turn it off half the time, then this might actually be something worth exploring. But if you're somebody who rarely has issues with VPN blocks, you love your system-wide VPN and you want maximum coverage and you kind of just don't want to think about this, stick with system-wide. So yeah, this isn't me saying system-wide VPNs are bad. I still promote them and I think they're fantastic. And you can see some of the top recommendations on our open source chart at techlore.tech/VPN. The top five on this chart here are fully open source and they have a lot of good stuff going on. If you scroll through and compare them, you can like do cool things and compare the three and see what they're good at. So yeah, I'd love to hear your thoughts on this and see what you guys think about this workflow. Figure out what works for your habits. I wanna thank you all for watching. Also, don't forget you can support us by becoming a Techlorian. It's on our website or you can find it all in the description. You can tip us some Monero. Anything is very appreciated to keep this content going. So thank you all for watching and I'll see you next time on Techlore.